In the shadow of the cross, Jesus told Peter that Satan wanted him to sift him as wheat. In Luke 22, this is recorded in verses 31 and 32. It says that the Lord said, "Simon, Simon, Satan hath desired to have you, that he may sift you as wheat. But I have prayed for thee that thy faith fail not. And when thou art converted, strengthen thy brethren." When Jesus told Peter this, of course, Satan did not have Peter, but he did have a desire for him. And so one of the lessons that we learn in this passage is that if Satan doesn't have us, he wants us. He has those in the world already. He wants to make sure he keeps them by whatever means is necessary. But those who are saved, those who are in a right relationship with God, Satan has the desire to get those individuals. And we noted that he wants us for his purposes. In our life, we're either accomplishing God's purposes or we're accomplishing Satan's purposes. There's no middle ground, there's no in between. There's no neutrality in this battle or in this war. When we sin, we come under the bondage of Satan and of sin. And as a result, we're accomplishing his purposes within our lives. But God's desire is for us to be saved, to obey him, and thus to accomplish his purposes within our life. Well, Satan wants us, he desires to have us, that we might accomplish his purposes instead of God's. But on this occasion, Jesus showed a concern for Peter, and such concern that led him to pray for Peter, that his faith would fail not. And so we see prayer's part in this, in that Jesus prayed for him. Jesus is concerned about our soul's welfare, so much so that he was willing to die upon the cross. In fact, he was willing to leave heaven's home to come to this earth and then to die upon the cross so that we might be saved. Otherwise, there would be no salvation for any man. But Jesus was concerned about our soul's welfare. We likewise need to be concerned about others' welfare. We should express that concern by praying for them, as Jesus did here with Peter. But then we should also likewise show our concern for their salvation, their soul, in working for their salvation. Teaching the gospel, that great commission that we talked about in Bible class this morning, to go and preach the gospel to people, to those who are saved, edifying those individuals, building them up so that they will remain saved. We need to be concerned about their salvation. But also, we noted that even as Jesus stated in relationship to Peter, he was praying for him that his faith would fail not. It is possible that our faith can fail. Peter, not too long after this, his faith failed. And when he was asked, "Aren't you one of them?" "Oh no, I'm not." And he denies Jesus three times. His faith failed. While some deny the possibility of apostasy today, it is a very real possibility. Jesus tells us, informs us of the possibility of our faith failing, thus no longer having faith. He gives us warnings over and over in the Scriptures to warn us of the possibility of falling away. He also gives us some examples of that very thing taking place. Individuals who did fall away. 21 of the 27 books of the New Testament were written specifically to tell man how to remain saved. And so there's a great emphasis in the New Testament as a whole to teach us how to remain saved, because in reality, if there's no possibility of falling, all of these 21 of the 27 books of the New Testament are worthless. They have no value to us if the impossibility of apostasy is not there, or if, as denominations teach, we cannot fall from grace. We also see in this, though, that one can claim an allegiance to Christ and yet be in need of conversion. Now, those in the world, they often claim allegiance to God and to Christ, and in reality, they stand in need of conversion. In Matthew, the 7th chapter, verse 21 through 23, Jesus says that not everyone that saith unto me, Lord, Lord, shall enter into the kingdom of heaven, but he that doeth the will of my Father which is in heaven. Many will say to me at that day, Lord, Lord, have we not prophesied in thy name, and in thy name cast out devils, and in thy name done many wonderful works? Then will I profess unto them, I never knew you. Depart from me, ye that work iniquity. Here's individuals that were in reality on Satan's side. They were accomplishing Satan's purposes. They were workers of iniquity, workers of sin or evil, wickedness. Even though they were out here proclaiming, why, we've done all of these great things for you, Lord. And they called in the name of the Lord, 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 have we not done all of these things for you? And Jesus says, no, you weren't. You were a worker of Satan, a worker of iniquity. Even though they proclaimed their loyalty and allegiance to Christ, in reality, it was just the opposite. In Romans 3 and verse 13, for not the hearers of the law are just before God, but the doers of the law shall be justified. It's those who do, who are obedient to what God says. The doers of the law. Those are the people who are going to be in a just and a right relationship with God. Titus 1 and verse 16 talks about those, or they profess that they know God, but in works they deny Him, being abominable, disobedient, and unto every good work reprobate. So even in Paul's day, Jesus' day, you had these individuals who were professing one thing, but in reality, they were something else. They profess they know God, but in reality, they were denying Him. They were abominable. They were disobedient. To good works, they were reprobates. As we look at our society today and look at man religiously, you go out on the street, are you loyal to Christ? Oh, yes. Loyal to Christ. Do you attend worship? No. Well, I think I can worship God acceptably in my home. As I saw one person, I believe I can worship God just as effectively tending my flowers as you can in a church building. See, they proclaimed an allegiance to Christ, but in their works they deny Him. Our society today within the United States of America, by far the majority of individuals proclaim that God exists, proclaim that Christ is the Son of God, and that the Bible is His Word. But yet, even though the great majority of them proclaim such, yet by far the majority of them will never set foot in a church building of any kind, much less the Lord's church. They proclaim one thing, but in reality, they're something else. Take a survey of individuals that you meet upon the street. Do you believe you're going to be saved? Oh, yes, I believe I'm saved. And yet, their lifestyle is totally contrary to God's word. And yet, they profess their love for God. They profess an obedience to God, and that they're going to be saved, that they are in a right relationship with Him. But in reality, the reality as far as God is concerned is something far different. We see in denominationalism the same thing. Denominationalists talk about their love for God, being obedient to God, that they are doing these great works in the name of God. But in reality, you start teaching them the gospel of Jesus Christ and they reject it. How many will argue and fight against clear statement in Mark 16:16 that we talked about this morning? He that believeth and is baptized shall be saved. Oh no, you don't have to do that. You don't have to be baptized to be saved. You see, in their proclamation, they talk about their love for God and the love for God's word and that they are going to be obedient to God, but in their actions they deny Him. Their proclamation, their statements are one thing, their actions are something else. We have those who are members of the Lord's church in the same condition. They proclaim how much they love for God, their love for God. And you can see that on Sunday morning, but Sunday afternoon comes along and where's that love for God then? Oh, I love God, as I said at home. Or do something else in my life. Oh, I love God as Wednesday night comes along and I stay at home because of one thing or another, one excuse or another. You see, our proclamation is one thing and we're over here saying, Lord, look at all of this. I've called on your name. I've done all these great works for you. But in reality, Christ is over here saying, hey, you're a worker of iniquity. You're not accomplishing my purposes. You're not living the life that I set forth. And then we have those who try to bring in innovations. For example, this past week I was in a discussion with someone who's proclaims to be a member of the church and how much he loves God and he's doing all of these great works. And yet, when we got down to it, in reality, he doesn't have any respect for God's word. Because I kept asking, where's the authority for this action? He has a radio program. And in that radio program, it's gospel music. What is it? Beatboxing and humming and snapping of fingers and things like that. Where's the authority for it? Well, I knew there wasn't any authority for it from the Bible. The reality was, even though he would never state such, is that that's what he wanted, and so he was going to do it. He has a proclamation of his love for God, but in reality, he doesn't. He will not obey God's word because he doesn't believe you have to have God's word and authority from God's word for your actions. Yet, that's the same condition of many within the Lord's church today. They make a proclamation, but their actions are far from it. We have some illustrations in the Bible of exactly this type of situation. Here's Saul of Tarsus. Saul of Tarsus was an extremely religious man. In fact, he talks about how religious he was in Philippians, the 3rd chapter, verses 4 through verse 6. When he says, though I might also have confidence in the flesh, if any man thinketh himself, or he hath whereof he may trust in the flesh, I more, circumcised the 8th day, of the stock of Israel, of the tribe of Benjamin, a Hebrew of Hebrews, as touching the law of Pharisee, concerning zeal, persecuting the church, touching the righteousness which is in the law, blameless. You talk about a religious person. Here's someone who was zealous as far as his religion was concerned. You would not have found anyone more zealous than Saul of Tarsus. Even to the point, and as we see in Acts the 7th chapter, the latter part at Stephen's death, here the people were laying their clothes at Saul's feet. And as we enter into chapter 8, we see that Saul was making havoc of the church, persecuting the church. Chapter 9, we see that he goes to the chief priest, and he gets letters that he can go as far as to Damascus to find anyone who is a Christian and put him in chains and bring him back to Jerusalem for the purpose of putting him to death. That's someone who's zealous toward his religion. He could state before the council in Acts the 23rd chapter and verse 1. It says, Paul, beholding the council, said, men and brethren, I have lived in all good conscience before God and to this day. And so you look at his life. Here he was persecuting the church, zealous toward God. And in relationship to the law of Moses, he's blameless, he says. And he says, I've lived in y'all good conscience. And again, he goes back to zeal in Acts 22 and verse 3. When he says, I verily am a man which am a Jew, born in Tarsus, a city of Cilicia, yet brought up in this city at the feet of Gamaliel, and taught according to the perfect manner of the law of the fathers, and was zealous toward God, as ye all are this day. I was zealous toward God, according to the law, blameless. Zealous toward God, living in good conscience before God. And yet, in that state, he was lost. He was accomplishing the purposes of Satan instead of the purposes of God. He could have stood before God as those in Jesus describes in Matthew the 7th chapter and said, Lord, Lord, have we not done many wonderful works in thy name? In thy name, cast out devils, in thy name done many wonderful works. And Jesus would have professed the same thing to Saul at that time as he stated there, I never knew you, depart from me, ye workers of iniquity. He was on Satan's side, even though the proclamation, the thoughts, the conscience itself, was the zeal that he had toward God. Yes, he had all of those things, but he was still lost. In Acts the 8th chapter, we see another individual. In verse 27, it talks about Philip, that he arose, went, and behold, a man of Ethiopia, a eunuch of great authority under Candace, queen of the Ethiopians, who had the charge of all her treasure, and notice, and had come for Jerusalem, or to Jerusalem, for to worship. Here's someone who has made a very long trip in that time frame, all the way from Ethiopia to Jerusalem, for one purpose, it says, and that purpose was to worship God. And we can't even get in our car and make a couple of miles journey on Sunday afternoons and Wednesday nights many times. Yet he could travel these hundreds of miles in a chariot for the purpose of worshiping God. This individual was a Bible reading man. He's returning from Jerusalem now, making that trip back home. It says that he was returning, he was sitting in his chariot and read Isaiah the prophet. So here he is reading the scriptures. Been to Jerusalem to worship. Now then, on his way home, he's reading the scriptures. And yet, the angel of the Lord had told Philip, go to that individual and preach unto him the gospel. And so when he comes, he sees that he is reading Isaiah the prophet, and he asks him, do you understand what you read? Why, how can I except some man show me? Of whom speaketh the prophet this? Of himself or of some other man? And he was reading, we know Isaiah the 53rd chapter of that suffering servant. And it says that Philip began at the same scripture and preached unto him Jesus. Now, why was there need? He thought he was obviously right with God. He had been to Jerusalem for worship. He's reading the scriptures. Why, from the appearance, many individuals would say, this is a wonderful individual. He's right before God. He's going to be saved. But God knew differently. And so he sends a preacher to him to preach the gospel unto him. And we see his obedience to the truth. Going from Satan's side now to God's side, because he did the will of the Father which was in heaven. Look at the Pharisees in the time of Christ. The Pharisees were a religious people. To a great extent, they were minutely concerned with every detail of the law of Moses. They were the children of Israel, thus God's chosen people. Here they are attempting to be totally committed to everything that the law says. And yet, Jesus tells them that your worship is vain, Matthew 15 and verse 9, that you honor me with your lips, but your heart is far from me, there in verse 7. In chapter 23, he calls them hypocrites. I think it's seven different times. He tells them that they are whited walls, that they make clean the outside, but inwardly they're full of dead men's bones. You see, they were religious, but they were religiously wrong. They were not doing the will of the Father which was in heaven. And they would have been there proclaiming, we are right with God. God approves us. The very fact that we're Israelites, that we're the children of God, proves that we're on God's side. And yet, they weren't. And so Jesus condemns them in the strongest terms possible in Matthew 23 and other places. Religious, yes, but religiously wrong. Their hearts were not right. They were not doing the will of the Father which was in heaven. Some in the church today claim allegiance to Christ, but in reality they need converting. James writes, and he's writing to Christians, be ye doers of the word, and not hearers only, deceiving your own self. James 1:22. We must be actively doing the will of God, doing the Word, if we're going to be in a right relationship with God. In the seven churches of Asia that we read about in Revelation 2 and 3 that the lectureship at Spring is going to be dealing with, have seven churches there. Two of them, there was nothing negative said. Four of them, actually, there was a mixture. And then, of course, the church at Laodicea, there was nothing good said about it, only evil. But if you look at the church, for example, in Sardis, Revelation 3 and verse 1, under the angel of the church in Sardis write, "These things saith he that hath the seven spirits of God and the seven stars, I know thy works, that thou hast a name that thou livest and art dead." The name that they had was one thing, but in reality, Christ says you're dead. We today can have a name that we're living. We can have that name that we're righteous. We can have that claim even that we're doing God's will, that we're pleasing Him, when in reality, we're dead spiritually. Of course, they weren't dead physically, but they were dead spiritually, separated from God. That we've been looking at, the church at Laodicea, in Revelation, the third chapter, is another great illustration of individuals. Why, look at what they say, verse 17. "Because thou sayest, I am rich, and increased with goods, and have need of nothing, and knowest not that thou art wretched and miserable and poor and blind and naked." You see, they had that name and they believed this is what we are, but in reality, they were spiritually separated from God. They were on Satan's side instead of God's side. They were, to a great extent, self-deceived. They needed converting. Saul needed converting. And thus, in that road to Damascus, he sees the Lord. The Lord tells him, go into the city, and there it will be told you what you must do. He wasn't saved on that road to Damascus because he still had his sins upon him. And so Ananias comes to him to tell him what he needed to do. Why? Because he needed converting. He told him to rise, be baptized, and wash away your sins, calling on the name of the Lord. The Ethiopian, been to worship, on the way home now reading the scriptures, even though he didn't really understand them and could not in reality without an understanding of Christ. And so here comes Philip. Why? To convert him. And so he preached unto him Jesus. And as they went on their way, they come to this certain water. And the eunuch said, see, here's water. What doth hinder me to be baptized? Oh, wait a minute, I thought he preached Jesus to him. That's what he preached. But in preaching Jesus, he preached the necessity of baptism. And Philip tells him, if you believe, you can be baptized. And so he says, he makes that confession, I believe that Jesus is the Christ, Son of the living God. And then they went down into the water, both Philip and the eunuch, and he baptized him. And then they come up out of the water after that baptism. The eunuch went on his way rejoicing because now he was in a right relationship with God, while before he wasn't. He was lost. He needed converting. The Pharisees, they needed converting. The church at Sardis, they needed converting. Because they were dead spiritually. Even though they thought they were alive, they needed converting. The church at Laodicea, they needed converting. Because while they thought, well, here I am, rich, increased with goods, have need of nothing, they were spiritually dead. Going back to our text in Luke 22 and verse 32, Jesus says, I have prayed for thee, that thy faith fail not. But then notice, when thou art converted, strengthen the brethren. You see, Jesus knew what was going to happen and that Peter was going to deny him. And then Peter was going to need converting. Yes, an apostle of Jesus Christ, but one who needed converting. The word convert very simply means to return or turn back or come back. Peter needed to come back, to return to faithfulness to God from that place of denial. The church at Sardis, because it was the church, it needed to return, to come back to where it was spiritually alive again. The church at Laodicea needed to be converted. It needed to be brought back from the once faithful state that it was in, as we see it written in Colossians, the latter part of the third chapter and the fourth chapter, needed converting from the place that they were, where they were spiritually separated from God and spiritually dead. Peter needed converting at that point. And thankfully, we know from history that he was. He was converted. In Galatians, the sixth chapter, in verse 1, Paul would write, "Brethren, if any man be overtaken in a fault, ye which are spiritual, restore such one in the spirit of meekness, considering thyself, lest thou also be tempted." And then he goes on, verse 2, and says, "Bear ye one another's burdens, and so fulfill the law of Christ." There's the need of going to someone and converting them. That's what Paul is talking about there in Galatians 6 and verse 1. Here's someone overtaken in a fault. What is it? They need converting. They need someone to come to them, the spiritual, and to restore them, to bring them back to faithfulness to God. In James, the fifth chapter, we read verse in chapter 1 earlier that we must be doers of the word in order to be justified. He ends the book in chapter 5, verses 19 and 20, by saying, "Brethren, if any of you do err from the truth, and one convert him, let him know that he which converteth the sinner from the error of his way shall save a soul from death and shall hide a multitude of sins." Notice Jesus says, "Peter, I prayed for you that your faith fail not when thou art converted." Now then James says, when one errs from the truth, that is a going astray, a going aside from God's word, which is the truth, and one convert him, brings him back, restores him, because now then he's needing converting because he's gone aside from the truth. He's no longer being a doer of the word within his life. Then he gives the result. He's going to save the sinner. Wait a minute. I think it's interesting. Verse 19, "Brethren," this is the way he starts this. He's talking to those who are members of the Lord's body, those who are Christians. "If any of you," who? People in the world? Well, they need conversion too. But now then he's dealing with those who are Christians. If any of you do what? Err from the truth. In other words, these people were following the truth, they were doing God's word, they were doers of the word, but now then they've gone astray from that doing of the word. Now then, that's the ones that he's talking about, yet he says, "Let him that know that he that converteth the sinner." This Christian now is now a sinner. Why? Because he has gone astray from God's word. He's no longer being a doer of the work. He is now on Satan's side instead of on God's side. And he's in need of conversion. So, that one who converts the sinner from the error of his way, what's going to happen? He's going to save a soul from death. He's going to hide a multitude of sins. Now then, if you look at that, that's saying in essence the same thing in different words. He's going to save a soul from death. Here's someone who is in spiritual death. He's saving him from that spiritual death. He's no longer going to be, because now then he's going to be converted from the error of his way. He's going to be on God's side once again. He's going to be doing the work of God. He's going to be putting God first within his life. He's going to be doing everything that God says. He's going to be a servant of God, yielding his members as instruments of righteousness, as Paul puts it in Romans 6 and verse 13. He's going to save a soul from death, and that death there can also have reference to eternal death, which would be an eternal separation from God in a eternal torment of hell. Hide a multitude of sins. What is it? He's going to hide them in the sense that he's going to be forgiven of those sins through the conversion that takes place. And he is going to appeal to the blood of Jesus Christ, yes, as a Christian, realizing that he has fallen away from God's will, fallen away from God. He now appeals to that blood of Jesus Christ, which continues to wash away our sins, 1 John 1 and verse 7, if we will confess our sins, verse 9. And so now then he's going to confess his sins. He's going to pray to the Father, even as Simon did in Acts 8th chapter. Pray for me that these things don't come upon me. Repent therefore of this thy wickedness, Peter had told him. So as he repents, confessing those sins are washed away by the blood of Jesus Christ. He can be saved. Why? Because he's been converted from the error of his way. He's turned away from the sinful life that he's living, that lukewarm life that we would see the Laodiceans walking in, that spiritually dead life that we would see the church at Sardis in. He's left those ways. Now then, they've returned to God, to Christ, and they're putting him first within their lives. And they're being obedient and they're doing the Word of God within their life. If you're not a member of that church that Jesus Christ is going to save, then we would encourage you, as that Ethiopian obeyed the gospel of Jesus Christ, we would encourage you to do that. To become a member of the Lord's church. Not a denomination, because they're not going to teach the truth. They're not going to stand before God in the day of judgment in that saved state. Do what God says and allow him to add you to the church. If you've become a Christian, but you haven't continued in that faithfulness to God, not been putting God first within your life, not been that servant of God, and really been doing what God wants you to do, glorifying him within your life, fulfilling his purposes within your life, then why not repent of your sins? Come back and be restored. Yes, be converted to Christ, and that you will return to him in obedience to him by confessing your sins and letting us pray with you for the forgiveness of them. So if you need to come this morning, we would encourage you to do so as we stand and sing the invitation song.